Okay, let's get away from HSV because I really want to focus on bacterial causes of children being sick in the hospital with a fever. The most common by far risk is urinary tract infection, and this typically happens between 5 and 10% of the time, perhaps 10% in the first month and 5% after that. Bacteremia is relatively rare, about only 1% of the time, and meningitis is even rarer than that. So the bacteria that cause these illnesses are very much the same. They're bacteria that the child was exposed to during the delivery process. Delivery is not a sterile phenomenon, as you've probably seen if you've been at one. And so, they're at risk for mostly fecal organisms, such as E. coli, or vaginal organisms, such as group B strep, especially in GBS-positive mothers who were undertreated or untreated. Strep pneumoniae is not a typical bacteria that kids accrue at the time of birth, but it absolutely can cause sepsis in these children, although it's much less likely than in an older child. Likewise, Neisseria meningitidis is incredibly rare to get as a result of the birthing process, but can rarely happen. Enterococcus is a more of a fecal, as is Klebsiella. And we're seeing more and more Staph aureus in these newborns. As we're seeing more aggressive Staph aureus types, like MRSA or resistant Staph aureus, we are seeing it now and then, and there can sometimes be outbreaks in newborn nurseries. Okay. I'm worried about urinary tract infection because that's the most common cause of bacterial illness in these children. What do I do? Whenever we get a test, we want to ask, is it sensitive or specific? In the case of this, we have two ways we can check labs in these kids. We can get a bag or we can get a urine. If a child has a urinary tract infection, the bag is more sensitive. It's more likely to be positive. If a child does not have a urinary tract infection, the cath is more likely to be negative. It's more specific. In general, in the United States, we've decided that the cath specimen is superior. Now, there are some ways you can work around this. If you have time, you might bag the child, and if the bag is negative, then you're done, and then proceed to catheterization if it's positive. But most centers just go straight to catheterization. Or alternatively, if you're incapable of getting urine any other way, you might do a suprapubic tap. That's where we insert a needle directly into the bladder through the abdominal wall to get the urine. It's actually a fairly safe procedure, although how successful it is depends on the experience of the practitioner. But in general, in the United States, we prefer to go to cath or a suprapubic tap as opposed to what they recommend in England. And the reason we went that way is because there's more and more a feeling that these urinary tract infections are not as serious as we've previously suspected. Kids tend to get better, and many times it's not truly a UTI, but it's bacteriuria, a benign shedding of bacteria in the urine. Okay. If we get that urine, we're going to send it for a urinalysis. And the urinalysis has several aspects on it that tell us whether the child is likely to have the disease. Remember, the more tests you get, you improve your sensitivity and you lose your specificity. So if we look at the individual elements, you can see that these all have different amounts of sensitivity and specificity. The one I would call your attention to is nitrites. It's 98% specific. That means if you have a positive nitrite on your urine dip, it's very likely that child has a UTI. Overall, the UA is a very sensitive test. It's 97% sensitive and has a high false positive rate, 30% false positive rate. So if a patient has UTI, it's almost always positive, but it can be positive in normal individuals. Remember those three numbers. How do we approach bacteremia? Very ill children may have overwhelming bacteremia or bacterial sepsis. And this is more common in infants than it is in older children. Untreated sepsis can lead to shock and death. So we do worry about bacteremia, but what's the likelihood of bacteremia in a very well-appearing patient? It's very unlikely. True bacteremia is rare, and when real, may even resolve untreated. Remember, you were probably bacteremic transiently yesterday when you brushed your teeth. Okay. So we need tests that can tell us quickly whether a child is at risk for bacteremia, so we can distinguish well-appearing children who we should worry about versus those who we shouldn't. And there are several tests out there. There seems to be early evidence that procalcitonin and CRP may in fact be better than the CBC in terms of screening for this. But right now, most people are still using a high white count. If the white count is above 15 or below 5, we worry a little bit about bacteremia. Coming soon to a theater near you is blood PCR. I suspect this may one day replace what we currently use as the gold standard test, which is culture. So right now, we'll get these preliminary tests, a procalcitonin or a CRP or a CBC, looking specifically at the white count. And if those are normal, we feel comfortable saying it's very unlikely this is a positive blood culture, but if they're abnormal, it might be. Hopefully, with advent of blood PCR, we don't need to wait for a definitive thing, and we can get that blood PCR relatively quickly. Typically, it takes about an hour and a half to get the test done. Okay, what about meningitis? You should send an LP in a baby if they have suspicion for meningitis. This is typically in children under 4 weeks of age, and maybe in that 4 to 8 week range, depending on whether you use the Philadelphia and Boston criteria as opposed to the Rochester criteria, where you only do it if the white cell count is abnormal. So what labs should we send that cerebral spinal fluid for after we've obtained it? Well, the first is a cell count. In a patient with meningitis under a month of age, that cell count will be over 21. In a patient with meningitis who's between 1 and 2 months, it'll be over 11. We should send that CSF for glucose, and generally the glucose is about 2/3 of the blood glucose. So if it's less than that, it's more likely to be meningitis. If you want to think about it, this is not the pathophysiology, but you can think about it as if the bacteria are eating glucose and making protein. So if there's bacterial meningitis, these patients will have a less than 2/3 of their serum glucose in their spinal fluid. Likewise, the protein will be high, so if they have meningitis, they should have a high protein above about 90. Gram stain is important, and if the gram stain is positive, it's very likely this is bacterial meningitis, but remember the false negative rate is high. So it's one of these things where if you see it, you worry, but if you don't see it, you don't necessarily know. Culture is the gold standard, and that's what we'll wait for. But that takes a couple days, and so these infants may be hospitalized for a period of time waiting for that culture to come back. However, if you send an enterovirus PCR on that test and it comes back positive, which typically happens in the fall and winter months, you're done. It's a very accurate test, and we will typically discontinue antibiotics, and if the child's well, send them home. But keep in mind, enterovirus meningitis can be very severe, and sometimes these kids can get quite sick.